newsletter. It shows information about basic supplies you should have for 72 hours. Okay, that's 4 days, at least 4 days. That's what you head for. FEMA says prepare for 4 days at least before somebody can help you. And sometimes longer than that. So one way to prioritize your needs is to think in terms of the 3-3-30 rule, which means you can die in about 3 or 4 minutes without air. Ooh, okay, you have to have air. 3 to 4 hours with exposure to cold. Like it's going to be tonight. You could die out there without something to keep you warm. 3 to 4 hours. 3 to 4 days without water, and 30 to 40 days without food. Okay, so you prepare that way. All right, so your priority should be air, protection from the elements, water, and finally food. And this is all outlined in this little newsletter. Keep it around with you at the house. You don't have to do it all at once. You can just prepare a little bit at a time, and pretty soon you'll have it all together. And it goes through the 3 hours of exposure, what to do. You're going to have some blankets or something like that, you know, to cover you. You're going to have 3 days without water. Well, 14 gallons per person for a week or so. That should be easily stored, you know. And there is, by the way, they mention it here, an ounce of silver shield. You should have silver shield. Now, I'm out of it, I think. I didn't bring any down here. Somebody got it from me. And silver shield comes in pint bottles.
Yeah, I got one.
Yeah, it comes in 6 ounce, 4 ounce bottles. I carry it in my pocket all the time in between patients. I spray my hands with it. You can just spray it in your mouth, and it kills every bug known. That's what they stopped the Spanish flu with in 1919.
What to do to you? You put it in your mouth. What's it good for?
It kind of tastes good.
What?
You can't tell, but what, it's water. See, it's just 28 parts per million of silver, and truly ionic.
Does it do something for you?
Form will kill any bad bug in you, and leave the good bugs alone. What do you want? So everything from wrinkles to typhoid, it'll kill. You see, okay, so that's good for. You should have it in your pocket. But if you have a big bottle of it in your emergency room, emergency kit, well, that's excellent. You can put in water. You can take water out of the Missouri River, let it settle a little bit, put this in there, wait a couple of hours, and you can have drinkable water. You may have a little formaldehyde in it, but you know, you killed all the bugs in the thing, see? So that's why you need silver shield. It mentions it a number of times in here, you know, to have it right there in your first aid kit. And you go 30 days without food, but I wouldn't want to try that, you know. You get awful skinny. You can start storing foods for a 72-hour kit or a short term, a 1 to 2 weeks. Dehydrated foods may be lightweight, but you need a little water to rehydrate them, you know. There's dried fruit, there's nuts, trail mixes. They're great because they provide a lot of energy and be consumed on the go. And when almond butter in plastic containers, protein or energy bars. There's an energy bar that I usually have in my pocket, but I don't have right now, I think. Have in my coat. It came from the Barlow Herbal Company that makes this LDM-100. Boy, are they good. Eat one of them, you're not hungry that day. Woo, are they good. They're real heavy and complete meal. And so I stick some of those away there. And it tells you how to do this. And, of course, canned tuna or sardines, you know, are not bad. You know, they last an awful long time in a can, sealed. And you can peel them without a can opener. Just open them up. You can live on those boogers. And there's lighting to, you know, you always should have a flashlight on you. Always a flashlight. You should have a battery-powered radio is helpful, so that you can listen for news and stuff. And in cooking, you know, see, there's always a way to carry little lights with you, you know. Always need a light. And in cooking, it tells you can have a little camp stove or an outdoor grill. Good option, you know. And you have to think about sanitation. There's little porta-potties, you know. And there's silver shield gel, Always have that on hand. There's a can of it like this. If you have a scrape or a, there's a lady today that had a huge things coming out on her back, and she didn't want to poke them because the doctor said they were dangerous. They're loaded with viruses. Just leave them alone. Well, need to come out, and you need to open that. You need to put Silver Shield gel on there. It'll heal it up and kill any viruses or bacteria that's associated with it. So that's simple. The stupid doctor doesn't know that, you know. He doesn't have anything he can rely on. And there's bug out bags that you can keep your supplies in one place or in a pack or portable container in a case you have to, in case you have to evacuate. And there's other ideas in here: multi-tools, high-quality knife. You probably need that. A sewing kit, maybe. And it goes through the basic first aid supplies, though. Here, a pair of scissors, some tweezers, some gauze, you know, in case you're injured. An oral thermometer is nice too. Non-glass and triangular bandages for slings and things like that. There's a few things you put in just a little first aid kit. And this is all. By the way, I was hit by a car. That was. Yeah, I remember the car sliding at me at some speed, and I turned my head, and there it was, a car coming at me 35 miles an hour sideways, coming down the ice last December, and I couldn't get out of that, so I hit the air, and it hit me and knocked me into the about 30 feet into the yard, and tore this knee up, just ripped it all to pieces, and I was crawling around in the snow, holding my knee, and the car wrapped around the tree in front of my, just right in front of me. That tree saved me, it would have killed me. And so anyway, the lady was in shock that was driving it. She was a 19-year-old girl with no frontal lobe, driving on ice for the first time. And and she was in shock. Her pupils were as big as her iris. And so I drug her out of there with one leg and drug her into the house. We had this distress remedy that Nature Sunshine puts out for just such purposes. When you see a person in shock, your pupil's huge. It's about as big as the iris itself. And they're just no energy at all. They're just in shock. And I was getting that way myself. So I put it under my tongue and put it under her tongue. Her pupil came down. She came to and talked to me. And so we got the car out of the yard and stuff like that. And I had to regrow my knee. Okay, but that distress remedy should always be around. It's the old rescue remedy of Dr. Bach, B-A-C-H. Dr. Bach had this rescue remedy he made years ago. And had just a few herbs in there, five herbs in there. They've added a couple now that really help out for shock. And you put it under your tongue, and you come, clarity of thought comes in. You know what to do because you really are shook up, you know, in a situation like that. Always have distress remedy around. It doesn't cost much, and it can save your life. It can get you out of shock. And there's one called Anxious Less, and there's one called Stress J Liquid for kids. But it goes through this, remedies for infection, Silver Shield, high-potency garlic, echinacea, tea tree oil. We have Essential Shield, and we have Dr. Hill put together On Guard. And you can even, one of these things, you have electricity, just throw that in the room, and it'll kill all the bugs in the room. All the infection in the room will be gone pretty soon. Oregano, rosemary, and cinnamon, and those things. And you can carry that on you in little bottles or in your kit. Yeah, and there's On Guard is just excellent for that. And there's remedies for pain like IF Relief Formula, Curcumin BP for inflammation. And there's Deep Relief Oil, this Taifu oil. I always carry that in my pocket. Of course, I got big pockets. And I have these people staggering there. Tomorrow we'll have terrible problems. There's a girl coming in tomorrow after my radio show with rheumatoid arthritis, hurting so bad she can't stand it. She's 16 years old, in a wheelchair, and on prednisone. That's all they know what to do. Yeah, isn't that pitiful? We have all these good things for that, and of course they don't know the cause of it, and we have to get to the cause of that. But Taifu lotion is going to really help, putting that just on the wrists and the hands. It's just excellent. Penetrate, smells good. Blow it up your nose and you just, you're awake. You can't beat Taifu oil. And they have that in a lotion too to put on people with arthritis. So it's a very good sunshine sharing Here, just pass those right on down the line. Newsletter. Just keep this around because this is really handy. And here you go, kids. It outlines what you should do for at least a 72-hour period, see? I wanted to get that to you. Here's Master Arn thing there. I just saw something in the luxury magazine. I don't know how I got that, but you'll find that. I'll just pass this through the. Look at these cliffs. These are the highest cliffs in the world that they know of, over 3,300 feet. This is in Molokai. You look at those cliffs. And at the top of those cliffs was a sandalwood forest. And years ago, centuries, that sandalwood forest grew there. An excellent, excellent oil, yes. Yeah, you have. So I used to go over there and help the lepers there. When those big cliffs flatten out there, there's where the leper colony was. I would camp up on top of that cliff back in the 60s. I would watch the lepers in my binoculars. And I'd watch them every year, and I got real interested in what they were doing down there. So I called and asked if I couldn't come in. They said, "Are you a relative?" And I said, "No." "Well, you can't come in." I said, "Well, I'm a doctor." "Well, you can come in." I said, "Okay." So I said, "Are you coming in by boat or plane?" I said, "Well, I'm coming down the mountain." "Oh, no." "Yes." I said, "There's a trail there left by Father Damien, a Catholic priest that went in there and helped the lepers years and years ago because they were in sad shape. He went in there and straightened them up, built a church, and he really rescued them. And he died with leprosy in there. However, somebody who lives in the middle of the country like me doesn't catch the stuff. You have to live along the coast, you know. So the story of that is quite profound, you know. So I went in there and helped them each year for a few years. Till 1969, they closed the leper colony and shipped them all over to Tripler's Hospital, which overlooks Pearl Harbor. That the Pink Hospital up there on the hill overlooking Pearl Harbor, the left wing of it is all Hansen's disease, that's leprosy. And there's various forms of it, tubular and such like this. But what's interesting about that place was that when I camped up there, the wind coming off those high cliffs, going through those sandalwood forest trees, went at night, you know. Well, they regarded it as kapu. It was haunted. And the Hawaiians wouldn't go up there. It was haunted. And it sounded like it was, you know, at night. It was hair-raising. The wind coming off there 50 miles an hour up those cliffs, going through those sandalwood trees. Well, in the 15th century, the Japanese came over, the Chinese did, and they found that they were hunting the world for sandalwood. And that's how important that oil is. It's very, very beautiful. And we have some of it here in case you want to smell some of it later on. Smell real sandalwood. Wow. And it has a lot of healing qualities. The Chinese dug a big hole up on the top of that ridge there where the forest was. And I saw that, and I didn't know what it was at first. It looked like the bow of a ship. And so I went down to Honolulu in the museum there to ask what that was. And somebody, that lady that lived in Molokai, told me, "You were there?" I said, "Yes, that's haunted." I said, "I know, I haunted it." And so she said, "But," I said, "What is it?" Well, it's when the Chinese came over in the 15th century, built a big a hole there, the size of the hull of their ship. So they cut down the sandalwood trees and put it in there, and that was a boatload. And they lowered it down those 3,000-foot cliffs, loaded their boats, and sailed off to China. Well, today we recognize the best sandalwood in the world is still grows there. It's just the perfect place for that tree to grow. And doTERRA is harvesting that now. And that is the best. It's my favorite oil, and it's antibiotic. It is good for the skin. It's good for wrinkles. It's just good for just about everything. And sandalwood is one of the premier oils of the world. And it's expensive. There's not a lot of it, but it's from Hawaii, and that's where we get it. Now, see at the tops of those mountains there. So I had a lot of fun with those people, and it's quite a story. But that's later on. I'll tell you about it. However. Dr. Blaylock comes along. He's a neurosurgeon, a wonderful guy, and he admits that he didn't know a whole lot. You know, he just read the American Medical Association Journal and the New England Journal of Medicine, like most doctors do, and maybe an additional journal that covers their specialty, and that was about it. He thought he knew the world. Ooh, he didn't know anything. They didn't realize that they are unaware of 99.9%, he says, of the information in some of the most prestigious journals that deal with sickness and disease and how to heal them. So the doctors don't know how. They simply don't know how. I had three calls yesterday and several today on what we're going to talk about today, you know, is they're dealing with terrible things. Even my son-in-law had a foot and a half of his bowel cut out the other day because it was an infection in his sigmoid colon. I said, Dave, do you have to resort to surgery for infection? Yeah, they don't have any antibiotic that'll handle it. See, that's because his surgeons and his doctors he went to, that he worships, do not know about LDM-100. Even though that's in the U.S., you know, formulary as stopping the plague known as the Spanish flu and saving millions of people and killing any bug they know of real well, they don't know about that because they're reading the New England Journal of Medicine, which doesn't mention it, see? So this is what Dr. Blaylock found out, that in all these studies and the history of these things, he found out he didn't know 99.9% of what he should have known. And now he's retired as a brain surgeon, and he's writing these wonderful newsletters about it. So when he began to study the intricacies of disease and all that science had learned about how the body, especially the cells, actually function, he was amazed. And now when someone talks to him about an incurable disease that you have to cut out, I always tell that person that it's curable. It's incurable within the world of traditional medicine. But alternative medicine has the answer. It has either a cure or a treatment to improve the condition so you'll live a long time in almost every case. And this really surprised him. So he began to study. Now, I've taken his newsletters for years. And now the old boy, I like him because I don't get on the internet much. I'm, you know, electronically challenged. however, he brought up 67 studies from the internet to prove what he's talking about here on MSG and sulfites. Just a couple of subjects. He said that these are being ignored. Well, obviously they are, because this guy that I just got off the phone with a few hours ago, he's out in west of Topeka, and he's bleeding from the bowel so bad he can't come in to see me. The doctor's got him on prednisone. That's all they know what to do. His face is swelling. His hair is falling out. He's feeling awful and depressed, and he says, can I do anything but prednisone? Of course. Prednisone doesn't do anything. It's for inflammation. It's not even a good antibiotic. And this guy is bleeding from the bowels. I said, did he tell you to get off the wheat? Huh? He said, you can't eat wheat. You can't touch wheat if you're bleeding from the bowels. You can't eat anything with gluten in it. That's number one move. Number two, are you eating meat? Yeah. He said, you can eat anything you want to. He told him he can eat anything he wants to. Why? Because he doesn't know anything. He read the New England Journal of Medicine. It doesn't tell you anything about nutrition or anything. You know, it tells you about the latest drugs. So it's pitiful. And I have a book. Did I bring it? No? You know, meant to throw it in there. It's an autopsy book. And it shows you exactly what we're facing. Facing these holes drilled into the bowel, see, from just inflammation caused by these things that we're eating that are inflammatory. We have no idea how bad they are. Let's just mention a few of them here. He's going into this. And so he says this alternative medicine that he's talking about is based on hard science from the best researchers and laboratories in the world. I did not know this. I just read the New England Journal of Medicine, thought I knew everything. Who knew? This is hard science from extensive research in medical and scientific journals. And so he began to read them and study them and get on the internet. And so for almost 30 years now, he's been studying this process of disease that he calls excitotoxicity. Excitotoxicity, a condition in which the cells, particularly the brain cells, because he's a brain surgeon, and he saw this inflammation in everybody's brain when he opened up their skulls. These cells are overstimulated to the point where they die. They just literally go haywire and explode on you, see. Well, now, a lot of people come to my office, and they're holding their heads. Their heads feel like they're exploding. And what is that? Well, he calls it overstimulation, excitotoxicity. And now, how does it get there? Well, he said the taste-enhancing food additive, monosodium glutamate, is a powerful excitotoxin. And it means that it triggers excitotoxicity by delivering too much glutamate into the brain and into the cells. Aspartame, a key ingredient in a lot of artificial sweeteners. We were just out eating the other night, and the waitress came over and offered us a big old thing of just, here it was, aspartame. And we tried to tell her how bad that was. It's like, you know, giving me something with skull and crossbones on it. And she just laughed and just went on, doesn't know squat. But she's holding her head with a headache. Doesn't know that that was caused by the aspartame she's dumping in everything, thinking it's better because it's not sugar, see. Well, it's a food ingredient. It's another excitotoxin. It's an artificial sweetener. But glutamate receptors exist not just in the brain. They're in every organ. They're in your heart. They're in your eye. And eating foods that raise blood levels of glutamate can cause some major problems. He goes into this Chinese restaurant syndrome. Because of the high MSG content in a lot of Chinese foods, they called it that. Well, the truth is that most of the effects of this MSG occur silently. You don't really notice it over a number of years. It really builds up. And some people never feel anything as far as pain goes until it's too late. As the studies have shown, he said, that when you combine foods combining MSG with those containing aspartame, blood glutamate levels are twice as high as they would be if you just ingested MSG, monosodium glutamate alone. So it doubles the problem. And if you eat several high MSG foods, like chips, a frozen dinner, a commercial soup, your blood glutamate could rise as much as 20 times higher than normal. If you add a diet soda that has aspartame in it, you go up 40-fold higher than it should be in your brain. You see how it excites it to death. All right, and so unfortunately people do this all the time, especially young people, like the waitress we had the other night, just laughs and passes it off until she falls down with a brain tumor and wonders where that came from. Now, a lucky few are born with powerful detoxification antioxidant systems, so they resist this better. Does it harm them? Yeah, they just don't notice it for a little while longer. But virtually all processed foods contain one or more excitotoxins, and many contain as many as 5 combined, and that really multiplies their toxicity. So this MSG is often hidden behind innocent-sounding names, and he's got a list of them here. Hydrolyzed protein, vegetable protein, soy protein isolate, soy protein concentrate, whey protein, natural flavoring, spices, enzymes, autolyzed yeast extract, stock, broth, carrageenan. I just at the store just a little while ago picked up several of them. One of them was Centrum. Centrum for males, Centrum for females. It has these in it. Can you believe that? It had 2 forms of carbon. It was just sheetrock. That's what it was. And just describe sheetrock. 2 forms of sheetrock in there as a filler. Great. And then colorings and natural flavorings and stuff like this. And it had just MSG. And so when you see this soy sauce and textured protein and plant protein extract and hydrolyzed oat flour and sodium caseinate and calcium caseinate, and which was on the Centrums, by the way, it's MSG. That's another way they can put it. And so, nasty stuff. And sometimes it's in things called bouillon, broth, natural flavoring, seasoning, spices, carrageenan, enzymes, malt extract. It'd be MSG. They can do this, and they are doing it. And so there's programmed rise and fall in brain glutamate levels during brain formation. That continues in humans till the age of 27. Now remember, at age 28, your stem cells don't come out of your bone marrow fast enough to repair the things that are going bad. You start aging at 28. And the glutamate levels go up and down till that age. They really wander around. The oscillation in this brain glutamate is critical, and any disruption of the glutamate levels can have real dire consequences. And you can see so many people that age going nuts. Really crazy. And very high intakes of MSG or any other excitotoxins can cause abnormal learning, hard to teach them anything, addiction. In fact, they have an addiction risk. They like to risk things. They drive motorcycles, for heaven's sakes. they jump out of airplanes. Mm-hmm. They do things to risk things. They have problems with emotional control, endocrine problems later on. And so in the 1980s, Americans have consumed, since then, 282,000 metric tons of MSG and 800 million pounds of aspartame every year just in America. Millions of pounds of this going into Americans. This is why they're so nutty. Half the nation voted for Hillary. You've got to be crazy. Both are excitotoxins, MSG and aspartame. And they're found in foods, drinks, medications, vaccines, right in your vaccines, fertilizers. My goodness. So MSG, by the way, increases the risk of obesity. He talks about that here. And we were just noticing this as we were walking down together in Mexico. In Mexico, you see the American citizens over there shopping. They're all fat. They're all waddling down the streets, you know, and the Mexicans just picking them clean. But you go to other countries, you don't see this huge, huge population we have here. The country doesn't put up with it. However, this condition is very difficult to combat. You can't do it through dieting. Exercise has no effect. You just keep getting fat, and you hold it. That's what MSG does. It's a salt. You don't drink salts or eat salts. Salt is bad news. I mean, as such, sodium chloride is deadly. And the trucks that haul it have skull and crossbones on it. But it's not as bad as MSG. Animals with diets high in MSG, he says, tend to favor sweetened foods. Normally, an animal won't just go after sweetened foods, but they do if they're on MSG, over their traditional diets.
Oh,
and we see that with children, too. Yeah,
Dave. You're talking about salt, like black pepper.
Yeah, black pepper. And Dr. Jensen would not let any of us use it. He wouldn't have it on the farm, and he was the best nutritionist in the world, which so many Americans have, you know. And the numbers continue to increase. There's at least 45 to 50 million Americans with this metabolic syndrome now. And we can expect a significant increase in it, he says, in the number of young people in the 20s and 30s suffering from heart attacks and strokes in the coming years. They're having it now. Young people in there, I see in St. Luke's the other day, laying there, stroke or heart attack victims. We used to never see this in the 20s and 30s. The type 2 diabetes alone increases a person's risk of having a heart attack by more than 360%. And so as well, it increases the risk of blindness, impotence, stroke, heart failure, early death of all kinds. Diabetes is nasty. That's why my family didn't live long. They were all diabetic. But feeding MSG to animals dramatically increases the free radicals and the lipid peroxidation products in the walls of their arteries. They know that. This stuff eats your arteries from the inside. It has to plaque itself to protect itself. And it grows this plaque in there, and now you have high blood pressure, stiffening of the arteries, and you're going to blow. Now, MSG causes prolonged production of free radicals in the liver, the kidneys, and the brain. And this brain surgeon here saw this. He saw it so much, he had to speak about it. He began to study it. He was appalled. And so he went into it, and he said, this means that the diet filled with food additive excitotoxins causes you to age much faster and more intensely than normal, which increases your risk of developing a chronic disease. So he got the link there, too, between excitotoxins and cancer, because you continually irritate a tissue. It's going to die on you, or change its genetic mechanism, become a plant cell, live on carbon dioxide and oxygen instead of and sugar and oxygen and sugar and carbon dioxide and sugar instead of oxygen and sugar. Now you have a plant cell. You have these what they call vegetative cells begin to grow in you. A vegetable growing in you is a cancer. That's what it is. And you have this glioblastoma multiforme. This multiforme glioblastoma, I think in the past year, I had at least 50 people have that. Coming to my office, they had this diagnosis of this brain tumor. If you want to see what I'm coming out of a head, you want to see that? It's not pretty, I'll tell you. And right here is one of them. This is one guy that elected not to to have surgery, but to pull it out with a black salve. That's glioblastoma, caused by MSG and by radiation of a Bluetooth right on the man's forehead. See, here's his eyebrow. Yes, piece of skull fell out. The tumor fell in my hand. He's fine. But, you know, that is what caused that was his bad habit of eating and of wearing a Bluetooth all the time, zapping him. When you reach 3,200 rads of radiation, you get cancer. This also killed Ted Kennedy, who had all the money in the world and owned Sloan Kettering Institute and went to it, and they killed him, drilling a hole in his head and raiding his brain, trying to get rid of it, instead of pulling it out with black salve like we did. There's always a natural way to do this, you see, so it saved your life. Yes?
Is there an easier, convenient way to check your radiation levels?
Not really. You can check the instrument that's radiating, instead. You can check that, but how much damage it does,
right.
Not easily done.
Good.
Yeah, but Madame Curie proved that when you reach 3,200 rads of radiation, you get cancer and die. So, there you go.
That is where I hope I could
yeah.
Somehow.
Yeah.
Strong?
Yeah.
Vegetative cells survive on sugar?
Carbon dioxide and sugar instead of oxygen and sugar.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they start doing. Yeah, and so in a study with people with oral cancers, those with the highest number of glutamate receptors had larger tumors, higher rates of metastasis, and much poorer prognosis. So you see, it depends on the glutamate receptors and how much glutamic acid or glutamate we're eating and how that's affecting those receptors. So many cancers, lung cancer, breast cancer, prostate, colon, melanomas, have glutamate receptors. And if you have more receptors in them, you will have worse cancer there. They know this. So it has everything to do with it. There's a growing evidence that the artificial sweetener aspartame is one of the most dangerous food additives ever produced. There's significant increases in numerous cancers, especially brain tumors now, degenerative brain disorders, progression of multiple sclerosis, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, depression, there's suicide, obesity, headaches, seizures. My God, every day I have people coming in with these things. And this is used to be rather rare. It isn't now. It's just what you expect. And so few people are aware of a study conducted by aspartame's original manufacturers in 1976. Some of you may remember this. And when they demonstrated a connection there, when they studied it with rats, between the sweetener and atrophy or shrinkage of the testes in rats. Remember that? That study was done, and they admitted this, but they never pulled it on humans. No, just rats. In that study, aspartame was fed to mice in low, medium, and high doses. All three doses led to shrinking of the testes. It was very much more severe at the higher doses, of course. No one ever bothered to test humans to see whether they suffer the same effects. Of course, they do. You know, we're just big rats. So when aspartame was first approved, the legislators and the regulators said consumption should be limited to 2 cans of soda a day for safety. I remember this clearly. It was in the Kansas City Star, a big article. Well, they have since revised this amount to 17 cans a day for adults. Can you imagine drinking 17 cans of that slop? You know, well, without any new evidence to support their change in safety policy, they raised it to 17 from 2. And see, so now you just drink as much as you want. And we have people dying because of this. People coming in, 6 foot five, 135 pounds. What are you on? Well, I drink a lot of Diet Pepsi. The little gal that sits here lots of times, some of you know her. I will not say her name, but she's a little heavy. And she's right now battling cancer. She lived, she was just drinking Diet Pepsi, like who put it out? And she couldn't get off of it. And she's in there now taking chemotherapy and radiation. I begged her not to do this, but she did. And now it's shrinking. The doctors say it's shrinking. Her tumors are going down. Of course they will. You can kill those cancer cells easily, but when you get to the stem cell, that's actually the cause of these cancers, the stem cell cannot be killed with chemotherapy and radiation. So you radiate that sucker right down to a tiny little tumor like that, and they say, well, we got it in hand. Mm-hmm. And then, balooey, back it comes, and all over their body, metastasized and everything, and wonder what happened. And then they dismiss him because he's too late now. You're going to die. Sorry. Mm-hmm. And that's how it goes. Unless you handle it correctly, see. Well, we're praying for her, so. But it's madness, absolute madness. Put that kind of slop in them, you know, continually.
I have a cousin. He's about 25 years old. He had cancer. They gave him all kinds of treatments, chemotherapy. He got rid of the cancer, but he's had so much prednisone, he's going to have to have both of his five bones replaced.
Yeah, right. Destroys your bones right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They deteriorate really fast. That's what happens. Yes.
Back to the MSG.
Yeah.
It goes by so many different names, how can you avoid it?
Oh, but just eating fruits and vegetables and washing them real good. We'll get to that. That's what you have to do pretty much now, see, because it's just hidden in everything. And that's not just the beginning of the madness. The madness extends to genetically modified foods. And then he goes ripping into this. Now listen to this. So many people, as many people are now aware, a growing number of foods contain these GMOs made up by foreign genes introduced to improve resistance to bugs or increase the concentration of selected nutrients, regardless of the effect on the consumer. Now, he goes in and shows that farm-raised animals that give us our meat also eating these GMO products, the corn and the wheat and stuff have grown for them. They're eating this GMO stuff. It's estimated that more than 70% of processed foods in American supermarkets now are GMO ingredients. Close to 90% of all corn and soy products sold in the U.S. are GMO. The European countries I notice over there, Egypt, man, the guy from Egypt, Ahmed, he just was adamant to me. He screamed for an hour after I introduced him at the World Health Organization meeting, we will not ever allow that in our country. We will never allow this in our country. And I had to chase him off the platform. He was going overtime. He was just adamant. They will not allow it in their country. Why? Because they don't want their people to be killed. But we don't care about our supermarkets contain these GMO ingredients all over the place. Now, what's so bad about this? Well, the problem started when scientists began to look for ways to increase the protein yield of the plant crops, like corn and soy and stuff. And they were looking for ways to take advantage of how plants naturally protect themselves from insects and microbial diseases. They produce their own natural pesticides and fungicides. They do this to resist what they have to resist. So the plants make these protective chemicals, but these chemicals can harm human health if they're too high. They can even promote cancer development when they're present in high concentrations. Now, normally, they wouldn't be in high concentrations, but these companies like Monsanto has concentrated them. Why do they do this? By manipulating these genes, scientists can cause the plant to produce the chemicals in much higher concentrations for longer periods of time. So Monsanto and Bayer, I know some guys who work down in Bayer. He hates what they're doing. He sees what they're doing. He's a foreman down there. They're doing this right down here in Kansas City, down in the west bottoms, in the east bottoms. You see the big Bayer plant down there. That's what they're doing, making aspirin out of coal tar. So just coal tar going in you all the time, you know, when you take aspirin. It lines your bowel with a big black coating, and we pull out of people all the time. It's nasty stuff. And they're also doing this gene stuff. And Syngenta is one corporation that's allying with them. This technology, and putting in their products, it was challenged by scientists that were familiar with plant genetics and toxicity, but they influenced Congress by just paying off the congressman, you know. And so it's like two boys talking, you know. My dad ran for Senate. Oh, he did? Yes, said the other boy. And he said, well, what does he do now? Oh, he does nothing. He won. He says, he's a senator. He does nothing. Except, yes.
You're talking about
aspartame,
you know.
Aspartame, yes.
What about the sweetener kind of these little packages?
Yeah, they're all bad. They're all bad except possibly you have this...
How bad is it?
Well, you have some good sugars out there, and xylitol is one of them. It comes from birch bark.
I forget the name of it.
And stevia is okay. They're natural sugars.
What is okay?
Stevia.
Oh.
Stevia and xylitol are good sugars. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you know monk fruit?
Yes.
Is that okay?
Yes, it is. And he mentions it in here. Yeah, yeah, he does. He's pretty sharp. He's done his homework.
He would sit there on every Friday, you know, when the writer get together. He would take a teaspoon, put it in the pepper shaker, and put it on his food and eat it.
Yeah. I know.
Is he alive?
Just put sugar in.
He's still alive.
He's still barely alive, yeah. But But the committee's report demonstrated potential kidney, liver problems, damage to the heart, adrenal glands, spleen, as a result of eating genetically modified corn, just the corn out there. And so the Committee for Independent Research and Information on Genetic Engineering, it's a nonprofit independent organization, did some studies on the health effects of GMO foods. It wasn't pretty. In tests that favored the food companies, the government regulatory agencies require only a very short-term analysis, just study it a few weeks. The negative effects of eating GMO foods can take years or several generations to show up badly, to fully manifest the harmful effects in humans. No post-marking studies, that's testing for large numbers of people consuming these foods once they are released in stores, have been conducted. None of these post-market studies have been done on. But to prevent problems that would occur from being discovered, companies design their tests to their advantage. And this is how they did it. They used older animals that die before the problems arise. Take an old rat that only lives 3 years, get him in that last third of his life, and give him that sin.
That man's name is Al Bandrees.
Yes. Yes, I remember him. Al. Yes.
Put it on his eggs.
Yeah.
Put it on
pepper. Yeah. Yeah. Now, and also they omit tests on embryos, which are important for pregnant women. They omitted those tests. They tested only a few animals and using obsolete testing methods that weren't sensitive enough to detect any damage to start with. That's how they get by with it. And that's how they test it. And the government accepts this. In addition, as happened with aspartame testing, they ignored the deaths of the test animals. When the test animals die, they say, well, he's dead. Chalk him off. We just use the ones that are alive to see what's happened to them. And unfortunately, the regulatory agencies have accepted those studies and are just a few of the findings that they come up with about some of these GMO foods. This independent laboratory, they said rats fed GMO soy died within 3 weeks. And the mice developed pancreatic and liver problems. Cows died mysteriously when fed GMO corn and became sterile. When mice were fed GMO potatoes, they developed intestinal damage and bleeding stomachs. And sheep died after grazing in GMO cotton fields. This is what they found. It gets pretty bad. And these are rather large animals. A study by Russian biologist Alexei Sorov, he found that feeding hamsters GMO soy for 2 years caused a very high mortality rate in the pups. Of even a greater concern was the fact that by the third generation, the hamsters became sterile. You see what they're doing? They grew more slowly, too, when they did grow. So Sorov, he chose hamsters because they have a high production rate, of course. Each hamster produces 7 or 8 litters. as I recall. And the test then was used to control animals that ate a normal diet with no soy. But that wasn't the first study to show problems in these GMO soys. A previous Russian study by Dr. Irina Ermakova, and she used rats fed GMO soy during pregnancy. Half the rats' babies died within 3 weeks. 5 times the natural death rate in rats. In addition, the males had significant damage to their testes again. Studies from scientists in Italy found reduced sperm production and sperm damage in male mice fed GMO soy. These effects are not limited to just GMO soy. A study by the American government found that GMO corn really reduced the number of babies born to mice, and that the babies were smaller than normal, the ones that did live. And reports from farmers all over the world are finding that cattle, pigs, sheep fed GMO corn become sterile. And when they're given natural corn, they become fertile again. You can reverse it. Indian veterinarians are also finding sterility problems among animals allowed to feed from GMO cottonseed. And they have reported infertility, spontaneous abortions, frequent premature deliveries, and uterine prolapses in these animals. Wow, every woman who walks in my office has a uterine prolapse. Every last one of them. It's pitiful. So it's harmful to understand, it's important to understand, that even natural soy, it may be having too much glutamate. It does contain quite a bit of glutamate and fluoride and manganese. All three of these chemicals increase brain inflammation and excitotoxicity in people that are sensitive. Now, he goes into weed killers and the damage to the DNA and the fact that they cause cancer. And so we had a little cat. She was our cat for 20 years, baby. She was really a great cat and a cute cat. As all cats, they're a little offy, but, you know, she was cute. It's like most girls are cute, but they're dangerous. Okay, now, however, she went out and they sprayed the lawn for weeds. And she went out there and I forgot, let her out. She got on her paws, licked it off. She immediately had a stroke. Her eyes turned from beautiful blue to red and died. And just that fast. Amazing. And so he goes into this. Another closely related issue is the creation of these genetically modified crops that are resistant to weed-killing herbicides. In an effort to allow farmers greater use of weed killers at higher concentrations, this one company, Monsanto, it genetically engineered certain crops to be highly resistant to that weed killer. That would allow farmers to control weeds without harming their crops. And now they're stuck in growing that kind of crop or that kind of seed they sell and the weed killer. And the company can sell the special seed each season, and there's where the money is. They go out to farmers and stop them from using any other seed, in fact. And recent studies have found much higher concentrations of weed killers in these crops. Now, that's important because weed killers are associated with a number of deadly diseases, including cancer. And unlike these pesticides are used mainly for commercial agriculture, weed killers extend to millions of homes, golf courses, public facilities, all over the place. There's a growing number of studies showing that weed killers can just cause significant damage to the DNA and mitochondria of the cell, the immune cells themselves. And worst of all, they do this in doses far below what they use in agriculture. There's a lot of earlier studies were paid for by the manufacturer of the product or tested only one ingredient in it, as glycophosphate. Recent studies have shown that other chemicals used in weed killers add to the toxicity. There's one called AMPA, AMPA, causes considerable DNA damage. They didn't study that at all. And the studies did show by independent laboratories that AMPA, AMPA, is a significant endocrine disruptor, meaning it can interfere with estrogen and testosterone function. A French study reported in the journal Toxicology, they found that weed killers produced gene damage and were anti-estrogenic and anti-androgenic at doses far below they use in agriculture and on golf courses and things. So the researchers concluded that these weed killers should be considered carcinogens and mutagens and are harmful to reproduction. and other pesticides they mentioned here are also linked to a high incidence of cancer, especially lymphomas. I just got off the phone just an hour ago with a person that had leukemia and lymphomas. They didn't know where it was coming from. He lives out here west of Topeka. It's increasing more rapidly than any other type of cancer, especially in people in their 30s, which this guy is. He's only in his 30s. I asked him. He's 38 years old. Lymphomas. I just had a lady there 3 days ago in my office, and I run my hand over her arm, and just one lump after another. Lump, 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 lump. Where are these coming from? Oh, boy. Ask her a few questions, and she smells this stuff being sprayed on around her apartments all the time. Now, from the late 70s to 1992, that was about 14 years, there was a 50% increase in lymphomas, with a greater incidence occurring in the Midwest, right here where we live, because this is where everything grows. This is where the agriculture center of the United States. And it doesn't happen too much out in the West, in the desert. The strongest links to cancer occurred with phenoxyacetic acid, which is 2,4-D, organochlorines, this chlorodane, DDT, lindane, and toxaphene, and organophosphates like diazinon, dichlorvos, and maleathion. And they're all commonly used pesticides. You see them in your house. You reach down under your sink and you see any of these things in there, you get them out of there. And you shouldn't really throw them in the trash, because that's going to really poison the things. I mean, these are poisonous things. But get rid of them like you should. And then use the things we have. You know, we have wonderful stuff. I mean, I don't know why people don't use I didn't bring it down here. Maybe that's why they don't use it. The enzyme, you know, a wonderful enzyme we have just dissolves anything right in front of you. It'll take up spots off your, you know. And we have stuff. It'll be all right. And it's very powerful to keep your bugs away. Now, you should be especially concerned with 2,4-D, commonly used on pasture lands, lawns, golf courses, is strongly linked to non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And that is a plague, I'll tell you. And we just have it time and again. It comes wandering in my office, and they're just they're beside themselves. I have non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. What is that? Okay, it goes back to these things. Yeah. In 1992 alone, the EPA estimated 40 million to 65 million pounds of this chemical were dumped in the U.S. alone. And that was just 2,4-D. In 1981, a Swedish study found that there was a six-fold increase in malignant lymphomas in people exposed to those chemicals. Oh, it's coming from there. It plugs up your lymphatic system. It goes in your blood, and now you have leukemia. And leukemia is just an upset blood disgrace, as they call it. You know, and just different sticky blood platelets. Now we get onto the, I didn't bring it tonight. I'm going to bring it next time, next month. I'll bring the light beam generator down here, which is excellent. And holding onto these tubes, you see the sticky blood platelets in a blood test. And then just hang onto these tubes for about 20 minutes. Look at your blood again, and everything flows. So it's one of the things I give to people that have this non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Another study found a seven-fold increase in lymphomas for those who were exposed to 2,4-D for 21 or more days a year. Those people who spray this stuff have gas masks, but they still get it. Newer studies show the exposure to these pesticides, as well as the weed killers, causes chromosomal injuries associated with lymphomas, a very strong link to pesticide exposure and malignancy. Another highly fatal cancer is multiple myeloma. And how many of these people have been dropped in the past few years with multiple myeloma? And it's a terrible blood disease that takes them over fast. And it's just clogging up the blood. And may be linked to weed killers. In fact, it certainly is. And now, when we see it eyes in my office, every day I'll see people with these colored eyes. This sulfur color, see? It's just the color of sulfur. See that? That's not a normal colored eye. And if it's not like this, their eyes green, at least green. Why? Because of a light sulfur color going over blue makes green. There's no such thing as a green eye. There's no green chromatophore in a human eye that we know of. Go in there and autopsies. No such thing as a green eye. It appears green when you see a layer of sulfur covered over a blue eye. Yellow over blue makes green. Okay, so we have these eyes like this. This guy's about dead with cancer. And sulfites were behind it. And so, and when Dr. Blaylock got on studying this, we notified him of this, and boy, he started studying it. Listen to this. Sulfites have been highlighted in recent years because research demonstrates that they are more dangerous than previously thought. He studied this out, and he said, this is horrible. Sulfites are used widely in the food processing industry to preserve foods. Millions of people suffer from exposure to these additives, which are almost completely hidden from public view. Sulfites protect foods from such things as spoilage, known reactions, browning reactions, like cutting an apple, you know, it turns brown. If you get these potatoes, you cut potatoes, sliced potatoes, they always have sulfites on them, keep them turning brown, make them look fresh. They're there. And bacterial growth in wines, all the wine you have down at the wine shop down in Parkville has sulfites added on the neck, every last one of them. They couldn't find me a wine that didn't. Mm-hmm. Millions of people suffer from exposure to these additives, almost completely hidden from public view, or they're not notified that it's in there and it's dangerous. It protects foods from spoilage, browning reactions. In addition, sulfur dioxide is a gas they use to preserve vegetables and fruits and keep their flavor in. And you have to ship some of these long ways. You know, a lot of them come from New Zealand and South America. Takes a while to get them here. And in the grocery store here a while back, there's this English lady in there that attacked the grocery man. And the produce man was there arranging some fruit. She says, these apples, they all have wax on them. I have to take a knife and scrape the wax off, and there's that much wax on each apple. They don't allow this in England. Why do you do this? And she was really loud, and the guy was trying to quiet her down. And he said, well, because it preserves them. It preserves them? Oh, yes, those apples, they were picked last season. They're over a year old. What? She said. She put it back down. Do you have any apples that are not? Nope, you see, they're all waxed. And they're all a year old, you know, see? And that's something. Do we know this? Are we told this? And the most common forms of sulfites used in the food industry include sulfur dioxide, sodium sulfite, sodium and potassium metabisulfite, and sodium, calcium, and potassium bisulfite. There are six of them allowed in your bread. Just go down to the store here, buy your wheat bread, and look at the label. Sodium metabisulfite. There it is. Preserved. So I marked one at Hy-Vee up here, put it behind the others, and it was there for 6 weeks. Took it back out. No fungus ever grew on it. Wow. No fungus in 6 weeks. If you cook your own bread, that bread will get a blue fungus on it the third day. Mm-hmm. But now this will go 6 weeks. So that's why they put it in there. Wine, chocolate, cheese, most often linked here. And there is also a link between sulfites and glutamate, like found in MSG. It's a particular problem for children. Cheeses are also very high in glutamate to start with, which is one of the most common chemical triggers for migraine headaches. Studies have shown that during migraine attacks, the spinal fluid glutamate, a measure of brain glutamate levels, is really high, and it falls when the migraine is over. Does that tell you something? It did this man who's a brain surgeon. He said, that's the cause of migraine headaches. And so high brain glutamate triggers brain damaging excitotoxicity. It's excited to death. Well, you this extreme pain in your head is telling you something's wrong. You did something you shouldn't have. And then what it was is high sulfite levels in the blood and the tissues. It inhibits an enzyme called glutamate dehydrogenase, which plays a major role in keeping the brain glutamate levels from becoming too high. But when you put this sulfur in there, it ruins this enzyme. The brain glutamate levels goes right on up to the sky. And this can lead not only to headaches, increased risk of degenerative brain diseases, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, and a lot of others. Amyotrophic lateral sclerosis now is a plague, you know, where the kids come in there, young kids, can't control their muscles. Inhibition of this enzyme by sulfites also plays a role in asthma, worsening the asthma conditions, because glutamate in the lungs triggers severe asthma attacks. You see how far-reaching this can go. Most processed foods contain high levels of glutamate additives. And there's compelling evidence that high levels of these sulfites cause chronic degeneration of the nervous system and may even cause behavioral problems like depression, panic attacks, anxiety, ADD. Wow. And so here we go. The whole nation really is affected this way. Sulfites could make your condition worse if it's diabetes, cardiovascular disease, autoimmune disease, arthritis, or anything. If it's an inflammatory disease, it's going to make it worse. And so finally, studies can make cancer, it shows that cancer grows faster, becomes more invasive, and more deadly when in the area where sulfites are located.
You get glutamate out of your system.
Oh, well, one of the best ways to do it is by taking the hepatic cleanse. Hepatic cleanse. Yeah, the Tiao He cleanse, T-I-A-O-H-E. The Tiao He cleanse, it's a liver cleanse. And the liver has to discharge this stuff. Largely the liver has to handle it. And the liver, remember, on Americans is swollen so badly that it's pushing down on the right kidney to where the right kidney is kinking the ureter so that all the kidney stones now today, the operation is on the right side. And we have changed our anatomy charts. The ones you get from Mayo Clinic today shows the right kidney an inch and a half below the left one. Why? Because the liver is so swollen, pressing down on the right kidney, kinking the ureter. So, we have literally changed our anatomy. Yes?
Yeah, we really like the hepatic.
Yeah, you took it, didn't you?
Yep.
Yeah. You and Gabriel, the fellas living with me, they both took it. The next morning, they came into the kitchen. Well, what? They didn't get through yelling about that for 2 days, The effect it had on them, they felt so light. They felt so good, One day.
It's a kit.
It's a kit. Lasts for a 15-day cleanse of your liver. Excellent. We should all be doing this. Yeah.
Ron,
yeah.
I don't have migraine headaches, but I know people that do.
Yeah.
You say if you get fruit made out of your system as a cleanser, that would help you?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. This brain surgeon says that's probably the cause of most migraines. Yeah.
Can you spell that liver cleanse?
Yeah. T-I-A-O, Miss Nature Sunshines, T-I-A-O-H-E.
That's a kit, too.
Tiao He. Yeah, that's a kit. And the hepatic kit, it's got that in it. It's a little bit more in it.
In
little cellophane packets. You take one,
A.M.
and a P.M. Mm-hmm. And it does it. It's wonderful. Got everything from beet to, celery in there. And excellent cleanser of the liver. But it's impossible to avoid all sulfites. You just cannot do it. I've tried in the past, and man, there it is. On a label that I brought into the house. So the best thing you can do is avoid foods that contain the most sulfites. Avoid wine. Unless you get it from, Whole Foods or someplace like that. It has a wine sale every now and then. It says, unsulfited wines. And they'll have a sale on it every now and then. They'll be stacked in the aisle. And so there you go. White wines particularly, they're really loaded with it. There is beer. Ugh, I'm hitting where it hurts now. Now, foods contain relative high levels of added and natural sulfites. Let me run it off for you. Beer leads it. Dried fruits and vegetables. You see the dried fruits and vegetables store. If it's not in a health food store, even in a health food store, you'll find sulfited. Pre-cut peeled potatoes. Guacamole they make. Molasses. Shrimp. Soup mixes. Lots of soup mixes have high glutamates in them. Jams and jellies, cider, corn sweeteners, gelatin. And so, foods like salmon, dried cod, cornstarch, soy products, and eggs have a natural high sulfite level. They're high enough to be a problem for some people who are especially sensitive to sulfites. So you might note that, But there's a lot of toxic reactions below the level of awareness. You won't hurt, but you're doing subclinical damage accumulating over the years. And he mentions this. Now, vitamin E can block the toxic effects of some sulfites, but it can't stop the impairment of learning and memory, it seems. This might occur because sulfites not only increase free radicals, They also raise brain glutamate levels, and it's excitotoxicity that causes much of the impaired thinking. And fortunately, there's a way to improve the function of this enzyme, glutamate hydrogenase, and it has been shown that the amino acid L-leucine, these are branched-chain amino acids. You can find them in health food stores. Branched-chain amino acid, L-leucine, L-E-U-C-I-N-E, is the one that stimulates the activity of glutamate dehydrogenase. And this beneficially lowers your brain glutamate. L-leucine can be bought, of course, as a supplement in a combination of other amino acids, and usually it's called branched-chain amino acids. And it's usually put together with L-valine and L-isoleucine. But it enters the brain better than most amino acids. Now, L-leucine is generally safe, but it can cause hypoglycemia in children if you give too much of it. So it should be taken with full meals, not on an empty stomach. Now, there's R-lipoic acid, too. It's been shown to significantly reduce the brain toxicity of sulfites. R-lipoic acid. And increased brain glutathione. It's a major antioxidant that helps out on this. And there is high doses. Now, here's important vitamins and minerals to help protect you from sulfite toxicity. High doses of vitamin B12. It's methylcobalamin. You could go as high as 5,000 micrograms a day easily, and it'd be fine. You can't get too much vitamin B12. It does not have toxicity. And there's thiamine, which is B1, and 100 milligrams twice a day. Sulfites, by the way, destroy vitamin B1. And riboflavin, 50 milligrams at least twice a day. Niacin, 500 milligrams twice a day. They have P5P, pyridoxal 5PO4. It's an offshoot of niacin, 30 milligrams a day. Folate, 40 micrograms a day, or 400, not 40. 400 micrograms of folate would be good. A natural vitamin E, Nature's Sunshine, has a vitamin E complete, the three tocotrienols and the three the other kind. So there's six different kinds of vitamin E. And then there's magnesium. And magnesium L-threonate is your best, and it's Nature Sunshine's Mind Max. Very good. 500 milligrams twice a day. And R-lipoic acid is also good. 50 milligrams twice a day with meals. These fight the sulfites. Wipe them out. Get them out of you. Now, he mentions in here the flavonoids. They're really powerhouses, you know, of prevention. And we ought to concentrate on them. This guy has studied his food. He knows it, and this agrees with what Dr. Jensen taught us. Listen to this. There is a class of compounds called flavonoids, which are found in commonly eaten plants, and they not only slow the age-related degeneration of the brain, which you really have to address when you're my age, they actually can reverse it. And here's a list of them. Foods that include these flavonoids in great amount. Broccoli. Now, the difference between broccoli and a booger is that kids won't eat broccoli. That's the difference. Okay, however, we'll talk about that a little bit. Yes?
I interrupted you several times, but what causes gout? Meat?
Gout, uric acid, and there are different acids that can cause, there's a pseudo gout as well as gout. There's no difference in them. They're caused by acids accumulating in the feet. Acids. They go down. Uric acid, lactic acid, phosphoric acid, carbonic acid, mercaptic acid, all can create gout. See, and these acid crystals accumulate down there in little tiny little capillaries, and they rip and tear. And they eat your nerves. Now, here's the list of these things that have great flavonoids. Broccoli, celery, chocolate. Oh, man. Okay. Citrus fruits, ginkgo biloba. Leeks, onions, parsley, raspberries, and all these other berries. Red wine without sulfur in it. Tea, especially white tea, not the black tea so much. The white tea, green tea, black tea, in that order, are the best. Tomatoes, and turmeric, this spice in curry, and walnuts, Missouri walnuts. Those are very high in those concentration of anti-cancer nutrients and flavonoids. There's a lot of studies that show that while cooked vegetables had a potent anti-cancer effect, some raw vegetables didn't. And he had to figure this one out. The reason that is that cooked vegetables release the flavonoids that are locked inside the plant cells beyond human digestive abilities. And lots of times, it's not beyond our abilities. It's just that we don't chew. Americans chew about 3 times and swallow. They're in a hurry. They're all in a hurry. When you go down to Mexico, which was last week, we're down there, you sit there and you eat for at least an hour. And they won't come by to give you your ticket or anything for at least an hour, 2 hours. It's fine. You know, you take your time. Now, Dr. Jensen corrected all digestive problems and didn't have to cook hardly anything when we chewed 40 times. If we didn't chew 40 times, he'd bop us on the head. And we corrected all digestive problems by chewing 40 times. He put goat milk in our mouth and made us chew 40 times before we swallowed it. Why? Because the protein, the first stage of it, has to be broken down by ptyalin in your mouth. And it has to be in your mouth that long to do it. And so when you practice this, count 40 times. I counted the other day. It was 50. I'm old. Okay, so you got to do this. Nutrients in raw vegetables are so difficult to release by normal chewing that Americans do that a person has to eat at least 5 servings to get any benefit. If you eat raw vegetables, it's important to chew them until they are very, very soft and they just, you know, they're just digested in your mouth practically. So steamed vegetables are a real good alternative. He likes steaming. My wife does too. Got a big steamer out there. You don't ever burn anything, and it turns off by itself, and it doesn't lose its moisture. And man, I mean, I love cauliflower steamed. Man, you can't beat it. And avoids high heat as well as direct contact with water. Surprisingly, some vegetables contain compounds that can cause joint pain. Some peppers can do this, and it suppresses the thyroid function. Kale, broccoli, Brussels sprouts, when eaten raw, can do this. But heating them destroys those harmful compounds that is hard on your thyroid. So it shows you that there's 3 of them that you practically have to heat. Broccoli, Brussels sprouts, and kale. When you heat these 3, it breaks them down so they don't harm your thyroid. There's parsley, celery, collard greens, cauliflower, red cabbage, Savoy cabbage, spinach, broccoli, Brussels sprouts, and kale. These are the most important vegetables to include in your blender. And if you don't have a blender, get one. Get one of these little bullets. NutriBullet. Turns off by itself. You throw them in there with a little, and we do this in the morning, honey does it, and bam, we don't have time to sit there, but we chew this. And I walk around the kitchen, get ready for work, you know, and drink that. You don't have to eat. You get skinny, but skinny rats outlive fat rats, remember. So he likes to prepare vegetables by blenderizing them like this. He does this every morning, too, himself. He's found it out. It's estimated that the body absorbs only about 30% of nutrients from eating raw, chewed vegetables. Blenderizing them, you've already chewed it. It's absorbed at a rate of 90%. This allows the body to get a lot higher concentration of beneficial flavonoids, vitamins, fiber, and minerals. Just blenderize it. It's not juicing. It's whacking it up until, and you still chew it. But drinking a cup of a blenderized vegetable juice is equivalent to eating 8 to 10 servings of raw fruits and vegetables.
You mix it with a base juice, Ron?
Sometimes. I like several of the juices I like, and cherry juice. I love that. And sometimes she throws rice milk in there. The rice milk flavored with vanilla. It's good stuff. Yeah, man. And throw that in there. And before blenderizing the vegetables, though, you wash them thoroughly. There's a spinner. You know, you can spin dry. There's this nice little gadget. Spin it dry like this and add it to the blender. And you can start out with some pure water. See, He mentions distilled water. He mentions the best water to drink is distilled water. I don't agree with that. Distilled water is we say it's pure, but it may be too pure. It doesn't have any minerals in it. It's been removed. It's just H2O. Then they find out it's so hungry that it will absolutely pull calcium out of your bones. When they do this, the people that live on distilled water, look out. Distilled water. It sucks minerals out of you. Distilled water is distilled. It doesn't have any minerals in it.
Oh.
It says sodium and a little sodium left in there. That's about it. But we use Kangen water. We have a Kangen water unit which separates the good minerals from the bad. The alkaline minerals through there and the bad minerals go out another tube. So the Kangen water unit is used in Japan. Every third family has one. The Japanese are smarter than we are. We should follow their lead. Kangen water is a great one. And you just dial this up to 8, 8.5, 9, 9.5. You just get as alkaline water as you want.
It's a machine in your house?
Yeah, it's attached to the faucet. Very simple.
Give it out if anybody wants some.
Yeah, we'll bring some down. I love it. We drink 9.5, so we can cheat a little bit and say we need some slop and get away with it, some acid, see, and drink that alkaline water, you've neutralized it, see. But he says distilled water is the best water. Not really. They tried it in where they make these chips for computers and in a manufacturing plant in California. They want the purest water. They have to have absolute pure air. There's no dust in the air. They have great air cleaners because there can't be any dust on these chips. Just one little speck of dust will ruin it. So they absolute clean air, they want clean water. So in their pipes, they put in distilled water. In 3 days, every joint leaked. They had to replumb the whole place. It pulled all the minerals out that stuffed up the joints, you see, to keep them from leaking. That's what it does to you. It pulls minerals out of your joints. And they found this out in Europe. And so you don't want this, you know, it's too hungry. Distilled water's too hungry. You can drink it for a little while to cleanse yourself, but I wouldn't continue to drink it very long. Mm-hmm. And so now, vegetables have protective properties, and he goes into this, very powerful health-promoting properties. And these include the cruciferous vegetables of the genus Brassica. The Brassica are Brussels sprouts, cauliflower, broccoli, cabbage, kale. You look at them, and there's a cross. You can see, design a cross on the front of it there, on the top of it. And the sulforaphanes have been extensively studied, mostly for their ability to inhibit cancer growth and development. And there are vegetables containing high concentrations of selenium and stuff called glucosinolates, which include sulforaphanes. And these sulforaphanes are a natural sulfur that can inhibit cancer growth and is a very good cleanser to the body. They powerfully stimulate detoxification in the cells, especially your liver. It can increase antioxidant protection, inhibit specific enzymes needed by cancer cells to grow and spread, so you need sulforaphanes. And these cauliflowers and Brussels sprouts and broccoli and cabbage have that. And researchers have discovered that broccoli protects the heart, particularly the heart. And a study involved 35,000 postmenopausal women found a strong association between broccoli consumption and reduced risk of heart disease. It was clear those who ate broccoli got a benefit from it in their heart. And a recent animal study found that feeding blenderized broccoli soup to rats protected their hearts from heart attack damage. And the chemicals in the broccoli increased one of the heart's primary antioxidants. It's a thioredoxin. Reductase is thioreductase, and it increases the heart cells' production of protective molecules. You got to protect your heart. Eat broccoli every day. It dramatically reduces your risk of a heart attack. Protects you from other heart-related problems too. Now, it also reduces your risk of getting cancer anywhere, and improves your ability to detoxify internal and environmental poisons. So broccoli protects your brain. Your brain, the retina, and your heart. Those three places you desperately need this. Okay, and so he asks us to reduce our risks from vegetables. getting them from a store inside the city limits of Kansas City, it's against the law to spray sulfites on your vegetables. I caught one down here on North Oak doing that. I slipped in there at midnight when they were supposed to close. They didn't know I was in there. They drug all this equipment out from the back, the tubes and everything, and started spraying sulfites all over everything. Stunk. The guy had a mask on, and I caught him red-handed. I turned him in, and it's not there anymore. There's a filling station there, and they knocked it down. They made a filling station out of it. So, but outside the city limits, look out. They can do this. They can spray sulfites and everything. So the lettuce looks crisp the next morning.
So, Ron,
it tastes
awful.
To be
clear on that, mm-hmm. It's better to buy vegetables in Kansas City than Raytown.
Right. Exactly. And he says, grow your own vegetables and fruits. Grow your own. There's the hydroponic gardens that you can grow inside. We have one of these tower gardens. If anybody wants to see it, neat. A tower garden. Now we don't have a place to put it. We need help. Yeah, but there is these tower gardens are neat. You can grow everything from cucumbers, all kinds of lettuces, all kinds of things you can grow in this. And it's just a big tub like this. You can roll over by a window, light coming through. There's water in it, and you put little pods on this tower garden. It's 7 feet high. Then you just grow anything you want in there. Just absolutely, you grow so fast you can't eat it. Yes, anything but a root vegetable will grow in that. Hydroponics allow you to grow produce in the winter. And also we have this wonderful outfit, Mark Zamborski. Yeah, I had him here as a speaker. I'm going to have him back. And he has these greenhouses, 7 or 8 of them, down here at Antioch and I-35. And he begs you to come in and see what he's doing. And he brought us over the other night. 7 or 8 big persimmons. They're big Chinese persimmons like this. I thought they'd be sour. No, they were sweet. Oh, man, were they good. He grows them in the greenhouse there. Now, you can go there and just work there a couple of hours in his greenhouse and help grow these things and eat there. You know, he gives you all kinds of things. He has a big fig tree, 75 years old. You all see the figs coming ripe on that. You ever eat a fig off a fig tree? Whoa, is that good? It's the Antioch Herbal Growers.
Yeah, I know where it is.
Uh-huh. It's at I-35 and North Antioch.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Nice man. Oh, he's a great guy. And yes, he's just a great guy. He was in my house a few nights ago. We were talking all night. And wonderful things he's finding out and growing in those greenhouses. Go down there and he'll give you little jobs to do. Go down with your grubbies on, and he'll show you what has to be done. He's got a lot of, and people are going down there. It's kind of a community project. You know, he's getting them all helping out, and they can eat right out of those greenhouses. He even grows fish in there. Amazing. Hydroponics. And wonderful guy. He's smart. He's one of the smartest guys in agriculture. He's Mark Zamborski. Mm-hmm. Mark Zamborski, and
it starts with an S.
Zamborski.
Zamborski.
Oh, Z.
No, it starts with an S.
S. Zamborski. Yeah, S. Zamborski. Mark, and it's I-35 and North Antioch. You'll see as you drive I-435, I-29, you'll see greenhouses in there, and that's his. About 7 of them, and he has acres in there. And he grows a lot of interesting stuff in there. And you can help him out and eat fresh vegetables all year, unsprayed. Man. And buy locally grown foods if you can. There's organic farms around here now. They've gained real traction in recent years. They're growing at a rate of 15% a year with no end in sight. Because people are demanding this now. They're sick. They're finding out why they're sick. Sulfites sprayed on everything, commercial and GMO'd products. They don't want it. There's a number of companies that supply organically fed and free-range meats, too. Unfortunately, the government prevents cattle ranches from testing their cattle for mad cow disease. They won't even let them do it. One ranch had a real advanced way of testing them, and they stopped them from doing it. Why? So many of them have it. I wouldn't touch meat today in a 10-foot pole. I wouldn't do it. I just can't swallow the stuff. But if you do, you know, choose lean cuts of meat. Residues accumulate more heavily in fat. But washing vegetables and fruits are critical. You got to wash the boogers. Fill a 2-gallon pot with purified filtered water. Add 2 capfuls of vegetable wash. You know, there's this vegetable wash. You can use this soap that, that doTERRA has.
Concentrate On Guard.
Yeah, On Guard. Yeah, just squirt it in there. I washed my apples with it. I washed today. I washed even the wax came off of it.
You only need a couple of drops.
Yeah, and you could drink this stuff. Is that, you know, made out of essential oils, and that we need. Anyway, I rinsed the apple off. Man, that was great. And you can wash your vegetables. He says to take each leaf of lettuce, wash it, fold it out, and wash it off, and then put it in one of these spinners and dry it. And hard fruits and vegetables like bell peppers and cucumbers said need to be washed and scrubbed with a vegetable brush. Apples and pears should be peeled, he says. Well, you don't have to do that if you wash the wax off of it and wash it with that stuff that doTERRA has. And examine your fruits and vegetables before buying. Don't buy the ones that have spots and bruises on them. They're not safe to eat because molds, viruses, bacteria get on there. And do not eat peanut butter. Stay away from peanuts. Number one cause of bowel cancer in the world is peanuts and peanut butter. And those people who eat it are just about doomed to bowel cancer. They're great. Fantastic. Cashew butter, almond butter, sesame seed nut butter, sunflower seed nut butter. There's a lot of good nut butters, but not peanut butter. It's not a nut. It is a legume. It grows and lays on the ground. It gets a fungus growing on it. Aflatoxin, it's called. It seeks the bowel weakness and sets up bowel cancer. Wow. So many people today, you know, oh well, my father-in-law, honey's dad, died. Oh. He just couldn't get him out of the peanuts. And he died bleeding from the bowels. Oh, bad. And there's guys I talk to about every day that are. Do you eat peanut butter? Yeah, I like the stuff. Isn't it good for you? Yeah. No. Big articles in the Kansas City Star 5 years ago told us that. This stuff is lousy. Even the government's saying it has aflatoxin in every peanut they ever studied. It has aflatoxin, and that is a nasty bowel cancer-causing thing. And
would he live much longer?
Hmm?
Would he live much longer?
I think he would have. He was tough. He was tough as I am. He's tougher than me. And he died. He was 90, but he just wouldn't stop eating peanuts. And he was a salesman. As he traveled, he ate peanuts.
Wow.
Bad news. You'll die bleeding. Yeah.
So you're not supposed to be
nuts are, yes.
Nuts.
Yes. Chewed very well.
So it wouldn't matter with the peanut butter.
You'd have to chew them about 60 times. Yeah. What's that?
Organic or not, it wouldn't matter with peanut butter at the basis of a peanut
butter. Oh, yeah. Organic or not, it's got it. It's got the aflatoxin in it. That's right. And avoid injected meats and poultry. You might have noticed that most whole birds and many hams have been carefully worded in the label. It says they were injected with gluten or natural flavors or hydrolyzed protein extracts. You know, read the label there. That's a glutamate mixture, like MSG. They put it in there. It's toxic to your body, especially the brain. And percentages of it range from 6% to 15%. Look out for meat that has been injected. And there's lots of it has been. And wash your poultry really well, because the government studied it, and 90% of it had feces all over it. I mean, it was just really nasty. You have to wash it. You have to hold the bird and wash it really, really good. Many are covered in chemicals and bacterial contamination. Just hold the bird under the water. Scrub the skin with a vegetable brush, but don't use the one that you use on vegetables. And after you're finished, hold the brush under hot water for a minute. All food should be thoroughly washed before cooking, because it's really nasty. And most animals, especially cattle and chickens, are infected with carcinogenic viruses. A lot of studies now have shown that slaughterhouse workers, I knew one, and he came to me, and those who butcher meat, he showed me what he did. He's standing in blood knee-deep every day, bashing the poor cattle's head in, slicing their throats, and that's what he did for a living. He died, cancer. And the slaughterhouse workers and those who butcher meat have significant higher rates of lymphomas, leukemias, than the general population. And these are the same cancers found in cattle and chicken. Cook slowly at low heat. Do not sear or grill them at high heat. That generates toxic byproducts known as heterocyclic amines. So, and you add spices. Flavor meets with spices, not salt. You know, many spices have strong antibacterial properties and anti-cancer effects. Some of the healthiest and most flavorful spices we have: sage and garlic and thyme and cumin and turmeric and onion, fresh powdered onion, and oregano. These things really lighten, make meat taste good. Do not use salt. Prepackaged sauces present a lot of problems too. Barbecue sauces, almost all of them contain glutamates. Nasty things. It's also true of a lot of creamy sauces, especially white sauces. Glutamine additives are diagnosed as hydrolyzed protein extract, soy protein isolate, natural flavors, flavoring. They'll just put it under flavoring. Calcium caseinate, autolyzed yeast, enzymes. They just all kinds of names they hide this in. And this says drink the healthiest tea. And like I said, green tea is fine, white tea is better, and black tea is the lowest. But tea is a major source of quercetin, or quercetin, however you want to pronounce it. It's a potent anti-inflammatory flavonoid, and it fights cancer and protects the brain. So tea is pretty good. Now, unfortunately, there's high levels of fluoride and aluminum in teas. But it seems like the catechins in the tea bounds those minerals so it doesn't harm it. Catechins in the tea. Catechins come from kutch, black kutch, which is a tree that grows in the Middle East and East that is so hard that it resists being filled with water, and sinking in water for over 2 years. And the flavonoids in there and stuff is so powerful, the catechins are. And black kutch had so much of it that the ark was made out of it. The Bible says it was made out of that kind of tree. It floats in water for 2 years without getting waterlogged. Is that the kind that the ark should have been made out of? Yeah, sure it was. God knew what he was talking about when he told Noah what to make that ark out of, you know. It was because of the catechins in there.
What tree is that?
Black kutch. Black kutch, they call it. However, now, squeezing lemon in tea dramatically increases aluminum absorption, close to 700%. Do not put lemon in your tea. You want to use mint or something like that instead of lemon. Lemon increases the absorption of aluminum, and there's quite a bit in teas. Because it's harvested earlier than other forms of tea, and it's not processed as much, white tea has a higher concentration of catechins, quercetin, and these other nutrients. And it has far less fluoride and aluminum. So that's a good idea. Actually, the more bitter the tea. Now, he says, take 2 or 3 bags of white tea per cup. Simmer for at least 10 minutes. Squeeze the bags repeatedly as you let it simmer. Get all that goody out of it, see? And that's, people say, well, that makes it bitter. Well, he says the bitterer, the better. Betty Botter bought a bit of butter, you know. Okay. Actually, the more bitter the tea, the better, because the bitterness is caused by the catechins, the good stuff. So add a few leaves of mint to soften the bitterness. Drink at least 2 or 3 cups a day, and you've got a lot of catechins in there. It stays in the blood for 5 hours. 3 cups of tea in a day will cover most of 1 day and protect you pretty good. And if you're treating disease like Parkinson's or an infection, well, I drink more of it. So there's a, see, foods that harm, foods that heal. Very good newsletter.
You said white tea.
Yes, is the best. The white tea. Now,
can a person get that copy of that?
Yeah, I could copy it for you. Mm-hmm. That's very good.
Come over tomorrow and get it or something.
A lot of good ideas in there. Now, remember that, there's good foods that harm and foods that heal. There's good and there's bad. That is a novel idea these days. Everything's good if you like it. Today, you know, this. That's what the common thing is, you know. But Romans 12:9 says, shun what is wicked and bad, cling to what is good. There is good and bad. No matter what, who says what, you know, see. But who sets the standards? That's the question. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We don't set it. Eh? This has to be clear. He gave us our food. He says everything out there you can eat, you know, or use to your satisfaction. But we have to learn. That's what Adam walked in the garden with God for. He may have done that for years before Eve was even created, to tell what was good and what was bad, how to use it, and what was good in this and what was bad in that. And there's a wide variety of substances out there. So we have to learn. It's a process of learning. And what is bad, we don't do. What is good, we do. And we make this decision early in life. We try, anyway. So, you know, today it's just whatever you like, you do it. And, well, look at the sick population we have. It's the result of it. That all goes back to the Garden of Eden, when he told them not to eat of that tree of the knowledge of good and bad. What does it mean? Well, that means if he did that, he overruled God. See, God says, don't eat it, and he ate it. Are we still doing this? Well, of course we are. That's why we're sick and fat and diabetic and everything else, and cancer and dying before our time, because we didn't learn. And we've done this simple lesson. Don't eat that. He did it. And what was it? Tree of good and bad. That is, he fought for himself, or he chose himself, or Eve did, you know, to take in the power of deciding for herself what was good and bad, instead of letting God do it. You see, and God told us what's good. Genesis 1:29, read it again. I do give you green vegetation for your food with its seed, and all fruit-bearing seed as your food. Don't mess with the seeds. Just eat it with its seed, okay? And that was basically what Adam ate. 500,000 vegetables and 250,000 fruits. There's about a million of them that we know is edible. Couldn't eat it all in your lifetime. You started now, 8-10 of them a day. So that's what we're basically, you know. At the flood, he allowed us to broaden this out. You need anything that crawls upon the surface of the ground. His people, the Jews, he limited them in what they could eat and what they couldn't eat. But that was because he wanted a healthy population. It was healthier than the people, the healthiest people in the world were the Jews. We know that. They lived the longest. They were the healthiest. Why? They didn't eat bottom crawlers. And it had to have scales on it, you know. It had to be a fish with scales on it to eat. You didn't eat the sink of the ocean where all the waste of the ocean goes through their soft little bodies. You didn't eat that. And so he limited them in what they could and couldn't eat. Well, that limitation is gone because he cast off that nation. But that should have taught us something, shouldn't it? I mean, really, we can look back. If we want to be healthier, we can do the same thing. And so that's in Romans 12:9. Stay away, shun what's wicked and bad. Cling to what is good. There it is. And in Jeremiah 10:23, definitely says, it's not in man that walks to direct his steps. So we don't know what's good and bad. We have to be told. And we have been. Nature tells us a lot just right there. See, nature tells us, you know, something. And we have to follow nature. We have to study nature because the God of nature gave us clues as to what's good and bad. Yeah. Yep. Right. Just don't put it in tea, because it releases the aluminum in the tea. But if you get a lemonade going with maple syrup grade B, and you fast on that, you'll cure about anything. I haven't seen anything stand against it. I've had guys with cancer stay in my house for 42 days and swallowed nothing but lemonade and maple syrup grade B with a little cayenne pepper put in it. And they got out of cancer, they got out of everything. And they just lived on. I mean, it just disappeared from them.
Grade B.
It's amazing. Grade B maple syrup, yeah.
Lemonade's actually good for you, isn't it?
Yes. Lemons are great.
Homemade lemonade.
Yeah, homemade lemonade. Organic lemons. We got organic lemons. Honey does that. Honey did it for 14 days. Never felt so good. And so I've had people go 42 days on that. There's books written about that. It's called the Master Cleanse. The Master Cleanse. And that book is great to read. It's a great big book on how it affects every bad thing in you, see. And that if you just go on lemonade with maple syrup, grade B, to your taste, throw a little pinch of cayenne pepper in there, and you'll go. You don't get hungry. You don't get thirsty. You just come uphill. That's just all I can say, you know. It's just simple. Maple syrup, grade B. Real maple syrup. Not this fake stuff with, you know. Yeah. Well, the guy comes down in a big truck from Michigan. Herman, yeah, Herman the German. And he comes down in the big truck, and he doesn't use formaldehyde or anything to get this thing out of the trees. Wonderful stuff. And we just bought cases of it. And wonderful stuff. Grade B maple syrup.
Where does he come by? Is it out the city market?
Oh, yeah, you can see it down in the city market. And you can... Yeah, Herman. Yeah, he delivers to health food stores. And so you'll see them in grocery stores, though. Grade B maple syrup. Not the grade A. But they have it. Hen House has it. The stores carry it. But it's kind of expensive.
Herman's is better than the other stuff.
Yes, it is.
Doesn't matter warm or cold.
Very good.
Doesn't matter.
No.
What else do you put in besides that?
That's it.
That's
water.
It?
That's it.
Water?
You getting hungry? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Clean water. And you make a lemonade out of it. Two lemons per quart does a great job. And put that maple syrup in there. And you know, this guy that had cancer that stayed with me for 42 days lost 2 pounds. 2 pounds in 42 days. He looked good. He fired out of my house, went down to southern Missouri, started a commune. He's making tires, he's building houses with tires, stuff with dirt, you know. Can't stop him. And he's healthy as a horse. So that... Yeah, it saved his life. And that is simple. Very simple. And it's very simple to do oil pulling. I encourage people to do this. You
oil
get, oil pulling consists of taking about 4 herbs. Now, there's different recipes. But the one I used the other night, I really like, is 1 drop of oregano. 1 drop. Okay. 2 drops of frankincense. And 3 drops of melaleuca or... tea tree oil, and 4 drops of lemon. And you put that in a tablespoon. I used avocado oil, which worked great. But fractionated coconut oil probably is best. And you put it in your mouth and squish it for 20 minutes. And just keep squishing through your teeth. And 20 minutes. It'll take all the infection out of your gums. It tightens the gums. It whitens the teeth. It's just absolutely the best thing you ever did. Now, you can use oregano. Instead of oregano, you can use this On Guard, which has a combination of antibiotics in there that Mayo Clinic uses. Rosemary and oregano and different thing. It's a mixture. But you can take...
It's free frankincense month again this month, too.
Oh, that's right. What do you have to do? Order $200 worth, you get a free frankincense.
Yeah, $97.
In my history, oregano is like burned by gums.
Yes.
Too much,
just 1 drop with the others in there. That's fine. And it doesn't harm you at all. And this frankincense, you know, at the bottom, it's about 68 cents per drop. 2 drops. Fractionated coconut oil. That's the best thing. They break it up. It's a little bottle, doesn't cost much of coconut oil. Do you have any here, Mom? And it's very good to use because it pulls, it absorbs so much stuff, and it's a very good carrier because you break it up into tiny little molecules so that it holds the other oils better. Fractionated coconut oil is the best carrier.
What is that about the bitters? They said that the Bible said eat the
bitters. Yes. Eat your bitter greens, Moses said as they left Egypt. Then it's in Exodus. Eat your bitter greens. They didn't. And they died in the wilderness. We've never listened on a lot of those things.
Nature Sunshine has bitters.
Yes.
You can buy bitters.
Yes, you can.
What about the Swedish bitters?
Yeah, Swedish bitters are fine. That's one of the things it does is encourage the gallbladder to empty and make more gall or concentrated bile and thereby emulsify fats so it doesn't accumulate in your arteries and your brain and cause stuff like that. I was reading the other day, you know, things, nature tells us a lot of things and we don't listen. We just refuse to listen, you know. We make our own rules and it just hasn't gotten us anywhere, has it? And I noticed in 1 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul was talking, and in the 11th chapter, 14th verse, he says, "Does not nature itself teach you that if a man has long hair, it's a dishonor and disgrace to him? However, if any man... seems to dispute for some other custom, we have no other, neither do the congregations of God." What does it tell you? Amos was a barber. Cut his hair. That's what he did. Nature tells us certain things, and we go with this. But if we refuse to, we ignore nature, we screw up. You know, everything's messy today. The men have long hair, the women have short hair. Nothing is right. Everybody can use any restroom. It's just so screwy. It's just, it's so messed up that it's not even called civilization anymore, you know. There's rules, and nature gives us these rules, you know. And there's rules of eating. And these rules of eating, by the way, I have sheets on things that we should eat and things maybe not so good to eat, and then combinations of how to combine food so they don't harm you. Combination of food can hurt you if you eat the wrong combinations. So, and you remember on the Garden of Eden, probably just lived on apples one day and pears the next. And they were fruitarians, it looks like, which is about the best food that you can eat. So why don't we do that? It's really rather simple. But this is a very good newsletter on foods that harm and foods that heal. And the foods that harm generally have been messed with by man. You know, it's what's done. He also has a very good wellness report on taurine. It's a miracle amino acid that reduces a lot of damage that these things cause. And this taurine prevents brain aging. Next month, I'm going to bring out some of these things that a lot of the immunoexcitotoxicity that are triggered by our bad diets can be ameliorated by taking this one simple amino acid, taurine. There's taurine reduces epileptic seizures, beneficial Alzheimer's dementia, it prevents stroke damage, just so many things, because it prevents excess glutamates from accumulating in the brain and causing this over-excited toxicity in the brain. I see this all the time. We had a man in there the other day, a little strange, but he talked constantly. I never had a word in edgewise. I charge him, you know, for this. And so I sat and listened to him for a while. For instance, I just wrote down what he needed. He needed an L-taurine. And afterwards, I guess, what's wrong with me? I said, you talk too much. See, well, his brain was just going over acid. His whole brain area in his eye was just white, absolute white. He said, what are you doing? He says, I'm eating a lot of protein. I want to build muscle. I want to have a good body. You know, see, thinks you have to eat protein to do this. Not really. We're going to talk about that next month, about how little protein you can get away with, because if you eat fruit, you'll get about less than 5% protein in your diet. Adam and Eve were perfect and lived 960 years doing that. I'd say that was pretty good. 5% protein isn't much protein. It's not enough to talk about. You certainly don't have to go after it to eat it, because everything's made of protein. Your apple is protein. Your celery is protein. Everything's made of protein. May hold starch, may hold fat, but it is protein. Everything is made of protein. And everything is made with enough protein so you don't have to go after it to eat it. This man was eating solid protein. His eye was white with acids. He was into ketosis. Well, ketosis is not pretty. And his brain was just blowing. In fact, he's lost his job. They kicked him out. Where he's a hairdresser. He can't work there anymore. Nobody can stand to be around him. And you see his brain just blowing up.
All of his medication, cold turkey.
Yeah. Yeah. Got him off his medication.
He's driving himself mad with his diet.
Yes. Absolute mad. Yeah. And people around him know it, but he doesn't. See, so. And you can't tell him because he's busy talking. Now, I don't know. He'll blow his head off. Just it's terrible to see what people do to themselves when all that's necessary is to eat a little fruit, you know. And this taurine, though, is a miracle amino acid. You look at it, I didn't realize all that it did. But he, being a brain surgeon, can see what it does right there in the brain. You get this amino acid, and it calms the brain down. And it gets rid of this glutamic acid, or this glutamate, and balances it. There's a number of ways it does it. And it's very good for epileptic seizures. So if you know anybody that has these seizures, look for this. L-taurine. Uh-huh. Taurine, T-A-U-R-I-N-E.
Yeah, see? Go to our church,
right. And so taurine initially reduced the incidence of seizures. And so, you know, if anybody has that problem, remember this, you know. This is one of the things we're going to bring out next month. But in a couple of days, Honey and I are going down to Mexico. We're going to be in Puerto Vallarta. So I'll bring you back something. Maybe some toe jam or something. I don't know. Whatever they got on the beach now. So,
chocolate, good for you or bad for you?
What is?
Chocolate.
Oh, chocolate by itself is good.
Yes,
it was one of those things listed in there that has a lot of bioflavonoids in it. Good stuff, actually. Now, when you put all kinds of sugars with it, see, chocolate's bitter. It's a bitter substance. And the way the Aztecs ate it, it was bitter. They learned to put sugar with it later on. It's creamy and nice and soft, and it's a good texture, but it is a bitter substance.
The cacao nib is an extremely healthy supplement.
Yeah, right. And chocolate's not bad, but the things they can put in it can really put you down. See, yeah. So, but now I noticed that in Switzerland, we were in Switzerland, and over there they make their chocolate different. And you go to you go to Hershey, Pennsylvania, and I dare anybody to do that. Go there and go to the chocolate factory. It's a great big vat of chocolate cooking at 3,000 degrees to kill all the bugs and worms and things that come with it. It comes from Costa Rica. Anyway, and there's three tubes coming out of the wall like this, sulfur dioxide being poured into it by the ton just to kill the bugs and worms and preserve it. So we were moving, and a chocolate bar fell out of a box I picked up in a big house, moving it, you know, and it hit the floor. It's been in there for 5 years that I know of in that box, and no bug, self-respecting bug, will ever eat it. No, because it'll kill them. It has so much sulfur in it. Sulfur dioxide, clear up the yang-yang, so you don't eat that stuff. It's pickled through Armageddon, and that is poor stuff. But it's called a chocolate bar, see? Well, you wouldn't eat it. You don't want to eat that stuff because it'll preserve your gut through Armageddon. Now, if anybody wants this Modern Essentials, this is a little booklet I got here. It's really neat. It has the bug repellent, the bruises, the bronchitis, things for anxiety. What oil do you use? It's a really good little introduction to Modern Essentials, because I'll give it away tonight. So first person comes up after we dismiss can have that little booklet. And that's great. And so thanks, folks, for coming out tonight and on a nasty night. And we'll see you guys next month, okay? And tomorrow I'm on the radio. So that'll be at 12 o'clock.
Are you on the radio today?
No. Well, I should have been at 5 o'clock, but
no,
I wasn't. I wasn't in town last week, so
yeah,
I'm weakening, but I'm on my feet.
I sleep with a CPAP.
Yes.
I have to use distilled water in it.
Yes.
I use distilled water?
Yeah,
in it?
That's okay.
Is that okay.
Oh yeah, that's okay.
What you said, talking about drawing it out.
Yeah, and Typhoo, you need Typhoo.
Why?
Well, put it in your hand here, see, and it gets you out of CPAP. Now rub your hands together, and then breathe through it, like that. And you do this before you go to bed, and it blasts you right open. Really nice. Yeah, that is great. I had five of them just a couple of days ago, and they're all gone. But you get them from Nature Sunshine for, what is it, $11. And that lasts a long time. Just drops, you know. And it blasts you right open. Put it up your nose and go to bed. Oh, man, you breathe all night. Ooh,
okay.
Man, that's
we'll
good stuff.
On the internet, probably, can't I?
Yes.
Order
yeah. Okay. Yeah, you can. On the back, there's an internet thing.
Okay.
Now, here's the.